Well, praise the Lord. That is a powerful introduction to our sermon, to our whole sermon series. We're talking about spiritual warfare today. Specifically, we're talking about overcoming anxiety. And I know the Lord has prepared a message for all of us today, myself included. We all at times go through the hills and the valleys of life, and there are many times where decisions and struggles face us, and anxiety is one of the things that actually grabs the heart of all of us. We've been in this series now for a few weeks, and I thank you for all of you who've been responding, sending emails, how the Lord has been speaking to you and what's been important as you've heard these things, and how actually the service has encouraged you. Even though we're remote, one day, praise the Lord, we're going to be soon. We're thinking it's March. We're thinking the first Sunday in March, we're going to try to get us back together. So get ready for the office to let you know, and we'll be signing up again. And 60 or 70 people will be able to fit into our building. So first come, first serve. The Hardens are already here, so they've got first dibs on next week already, I'm sure. So thank you, Jackie, and we appreciate both of you, Tim, as well. For serving us this morning. Amen. Let them know that you said hi as well. We're going to take our Bibles. We're going to look at the story of Gideon. So if you could look at Judges chapter 6. And then we're going to look at a number of other scriptures in the New Testament as we learn what God is saying to us in this battle of anxiety and learning how to overcome. So I want to begin by saying Jesus cannot transform the person you're pretending to be. So no fakers allowed. Jesus wants to come to you just as you are. However, he doesn't leave you the same. When Jesus comes to you, he wants to transform you. So you need to be open to that, what you're feeling today is going to pass, and how you're struggling today, God can bring you to a solution to overcome and have victory in every area of your life. And it's good to be renewed. Praise God. So as we look at Judges chapter 6, we'll have the text on the screen for you as well. I'm reading verses 11 to 14. It begins by saying, for the backdrop on Gideon's story, it's an amazing story. And this is kind of where his story takes off, the beginning of Judges 6, but right here, the meat of the story. Then the angel of the Lord came and sat under the oak tree that was in Ophrah. I think that's a talk show lady. I'm not quite sure. But anyways, he was near there. Ophrah. Anyways, move on. Which belonged to Joash and the Abiezrite, as his son Gideon, watch this, was beating out wheat in the wine press, doing something good, but probably in the wrong place. And in order to save it, the wheat, from the Midianites. Just give you a little, we're going to see this word a couple times, Midianites. Midianites, actually the root of that word means strife. Striving because of the anxiety. So when Israel was conquering Midianites, they're actually conquering the strife that came from anxiety. Isn't that interesting? So to save them from, I'll just say it, the strife that comes from anxiety. And the angel of the Lord appeared to him and said to him, "The Lord is with you, valiant warrior." That's not how he felt, but that's what the Lord said. Then Gideon said to him, "Oh, my Lord, if the Lord is with us, why then shall all this have happened to us? And where are all his miracles which our fathers told us about, saying, 'Did the Lord not bring us up from Egypt?' But now the Lord has abandoned us and handed us over to Midian." Verse 14, and the angel looked at him, I believe with great compassion, like God is looking at you today. Listen very carefully. With compassion, the Lord is saying, "Go in this strength of yours." See, there's a strength that Gideon had that he was not aware of. And the angel of the Lord said, "Go in the strength of yours and save Israel from the hand of anxiety, of strife, the hand of Midian. Have I not sent you?" Have I not saved you, called you, sent you? I'll add those extra words in there just because it's for us as well. Anxiety is a complicated battle. It can provoke us or it can paralyze us, depending on how we choose to approach it. And today, we're going to actually approach it in a way to overcome it in Jesus' name. As Christians, we must not let anxiety dominate our lives, even though it affects our lives, every one of us, I'm certain. But Paul the Apostle said this, and I believe it's four words, and it's very hard to believe sometimes, and he said, be anxious for nothing. There's nothing that you should be anxious about. How many people know that's easier said than done? Paul knew this in the battle of himself. And in its own way, anxiety actually can become an idol in our lives that takes away our focus from God. And what does it do? It puts the focus on ourselves, what we're feeling, what we're experiencing. So if we're not careful, we can actually form the idol of anxiety in our lives. And we think that fret, all right, don't fret. We think that fret is a solution for us, but fret over all the what ifs that happen, that's basically the fruit of anxiety, is fretting. So instead of good fruit, you're going to have good fret. And that's not what God wants for you. Back to Gideon's story for a second. So all of chapter 6, Gideon's story here, and it's going to throw a little flash, a little screen of where we find him. So Gideon was anxiously hiding in a wine press to escape his enemies, it says in verse 11. Throughout his entire story, Gideon demonstrated anxiety and apprehension all along his journey. He's just like one of us. He's no different than us in so many different ways. He constantly tested God by asking him to perform signs to prove that he is with him. And that's what anxiety does. We're kind of, God, show me a sign. This is the struggle I'm in, but I want you to show me a sign. First, he had God consume an offering of food that he presented to the angel. Like, it's a crazy story. And that's in Judge 6, verses 20 to 21. Basically, he makes breakfast and then wants the angel to eat it. I don't know if you've ever done that, but this is Gideon. We won't speak bad of Gideon, but that's kind of a strange thing. I don't know if you think so, but I do. And then he petitioned God to send morning dew only on a piece of fleece he laid out, and that's found in Judges 6, verse 37 to 38. So we've heard of Gideon's fleece, and we do that today lots of times. We say, God, if you can do this, then I'll do this, or please show me a sign. Can I tell you that a fleece is actually not a way to be led by the Spirit of the Lord? Look at the next part of this thing. Then Gideon, what does he do here? Gideon then lays out the flesh for good measure and asks for the opposite thing to happen. He lays out the fleece again, but he asks for the opposite thing to happen, and that's in chapter 6, verse 39 and 40. And so we see Gideon really filled with a lot of anxiety, really hesitant to make any kind of decision. Apprehension is actually probably his middle name. Gideon was anxious, but when he finally put his trust in God, and you'll see that in the rest of the story, and I'll encourage you to read it all, when he obeyed what God said, the Israelites were then freed from 7 years of oppression. Can I say something to you? Sometimes our obedience actually becomes a blessing for others. There might be even people waiting on the other side of your obedience for you to obey God and watch the beautiful results happen, maybe in your family or loved ones around you. There will always be moments in life that we're struggling. And if I don't hear an amen in here, then I'll probably hear amen online. We always go through trials and struggles. But the truth is that we can trust him even in our trials. Can I have an amen in the house today? Absolutely. So obedience, thank you for that, by the way. Obedience doesn't ask you to be fearless, but obedience will ask you to fear less, to trust God and fear less. Obedience will ask you not to put your trust in your anxious thoughts or your anxiety. In difficult times, when we follow God, he will show himself. I want to throw a beautiful quote on the screen for you. Christian writer Corrie ten Boom, I'm sure you've heard of her before. She said it best when she wrote this: never be afraid to trust an unknown future to a known God. Let me say that correctly. Never be afraid to trust an unknown future to a known God. Now, this brings me to my first point this morning, brought by a thought. Last week, we talked about how important our thought life was. Because, you know, when we have fiery darts of the enemy attacking us in the spiritual warfare that we find, many times the first attack is in our thinking. And so that's why we're supposed to have the shield of faith and the helmet of salvation and the breastplate of righteousness to protect us from the fiery darts of the enemy. And those fiery darts are fiery thoughts that penetrate our thinking. In Gideon's story, the Bible says that when the angel of the Lord shows up and speaks to him, representing what God wanted to say to him, Gideon's threshing wheat at the bottom of a wine press. The angel didn't say, "Gideon, you're a coward. Gideon, you're a failure. Gideon," the angel didn't say, "you're just a disappointment. You're not in the right place or at the right time." He didn't say anything to put him down, or he didn't say, "How dare you hide in this place, in this way?" No, the angel looked at him, and this is what he said: "You're a valiant, mighty warrior." In other words, you're a conqueror. You're a mighty conqueror. And Gideon felt everything but that. He did not feel in any way that he was a mighty conqueror at all. But when peace conquered Gideon's thoughts, and this is the end result of that encounter with God, he became an overcomer, obeyed the Lord, and walked out that victory that God had declared over his life. God is declaring victory over you as well when it comes to anxiety. God's thoughts towards you are peace. God's thoughts towards you are encouragement. A lot of times people say, "I always feel condemned when I read the Bible, or I feel overwhelmed, you know, and that I'm not good enough." Can I tell you, there is some deception in that, because God's thoughts towards you are good, and they're peace and they're encouragement. What happens is we put them through our filters of anxiety, and then we think we're hearing that. We hear muddled. We don't hear clearly, and we're not hearing what God is saying. I'll say it this way: your future self needs you to tell your fears and anxieties to shut up. What God has for you is going to require something today for you to dismiss those lies of anxiety that's telling you. Just need to say, "Anxiety, I'm not listening to you any longer. Speak to the hand. I'm not listening to you." You're going to let your fears and your anxieties be defeated, because you're going to be caught with the thought that God has for you. You're going to be brought to a place of obedience because of the thoughts that God has for you. Now, this is important. Whoever speaks into you is much more important than who speaks about you. Some of us are so concerned about what others are saying. Can I tell you, we need to dismiss those thoughts as well. When we, which includes me, when we were immature, we cared more about what people were speaking about us. But as we grow older, and I think that's where I'm getting there, as we grow older, we realize that it's more important about who speaks into you than who speaks about you. You need to surround yourself with people who are going to speak the word of the Lord to you, encourage you, speak peace towards you in whatever circumstance. You don't have to be perfect. You don't have to have all your ducks in a row. You don't have to have everything all great and going really, really well. Because like I said before, God can't transform the person you're pretending to be. So be real, be honest, but let God then transform you. Here's a slide. It's anxiety girl. Here we go. She's able to jump to the worst conclusion in a single bound. That's what anxiety does for all of us. Anxiety, feeling uneasy, troubled, seems to plague multitudes of people. And in this season that we're in, this crazy pandemic that we're in, specifically in our nation, I'm telling you right now, it's human nature to be concerned about things that are around you. And I'm just speaking to all of you from my heart right now. But can I tell you that God has a way to help you in the midst of all the stress and all the anxiety that the world is throwing at you all the time? I said this, and I saw one time a funny thing on Facebook, and there was a guy that was wearing 9 masks all over his place, because they're saying 1 mask's not enough, 2, 3 masks, and he was wearing 9 masks everywhere on his body, and it says, it looks like he's been watching CNN for a couple hours. That's all I'm going to say. I don't know. Anxiety is similar to worry. You know, it's one of those things that is very difficult to overcome. But why do we struggle with anxiety? And what good does it do? So I want to talk to you about the cause and the cure, point number two, for anxiety. All right, the cause and the cure. So I'll give you this little illustration. It might be very helpful. Somebody told me this one time, found this rocking chair. Anxiety is like a rocking chair. It's always in motion, but it never gets you anywhere. I don't know if you've ever felt that way, but that's very true. Fear and her offspring, anxiety, when they're relatives of yours, I'm telling you right now, it's a hassle. Lots of commotion, lots of drama, lots of situations going on, and it opposes the faith that God's trying to build in your life. In fact, fear and anxiety are the opposites to faith for most part. Anxiety says, here comes trouble. Always looking for the negative thing to happen to you, and it arrives in your life to steal your peace. I don't know if there's people in your life that you go, oh no, here comes trouble. And you know that when you hang around them, you're going to be hearing stuff and you're going to be drawn into their stories. I don't know about that. But in reality, you might have anti-anxiety that shows up once in a while. But you need to treat anxiety like this relative that really needs rehab or really needs therapy. And you need to distance yourself from all the negativity that this anxiety can bring in your life. Because this kind of anxiety wears you out. It drains you emotionally. It actually really, really overwhelms you and even can make you sick. I don't know if you know about that. But anxiety causes so many, many of our sicknesses. When we trouble ourselves with anxiety, we torment ourselves. So how many people realize we don't want this in our life? Absolutely not. In fact, we don't want to do this kind of work to ourselves. The devil doesn't have a job to do if we're already troubling ourselves anyways because we're allowing anxiety to rule in our lives. So anxiety is a way, is the mind's way of giving you an illusion of control. And that's what kind of the root cause of anxiety is that we think that we can control what's going on around us. It's like the mind says, well, I can't do anything in this situation. Let me fret about it. At least I can feel that I'm trying to do something by thinking about it. And that absolutely resolves nothing. We think fret somehow keeps that thing on our mind, and therefore we can solve it because of that. Solve that problem. Guess what? That's ridiculous. It's not true. There's no truth in that. It'll drain you to the point where you have less emotional, like I said earlier, less mental, less physical resources to actually generate solutions. Be still and know that I am God. In that stillness, I don't know about you, sometimes in those quiet moments when I just take a break, solutions come. It's amazing when you let God begin to speak to your heart and let his word speak to you and watch the solutions come. Too often we experience all kinds of struggles, and I'll give you this little example here. During COVID, for example, you know, we're obsessed about COVID and all these kind of things, and our mind is on it all the time. Can I tell you, obsessing about it won't keep you from getting it, but washing your hands will probably stop a lot of your problems. Wash your hands and do all those kind of things, sure. But obsessing or fretting about COVID stops nothing. And so we realize how empty. It's a bit of a fantasy. It's a false imagination. It's a vain imagination that we resurrect in our mind called fretting. When I entered the ministry at a young age, I came to learn this because in my family, this really wasn't experienced. We weren't really anxious family. My mom, my dad, there was not anxiety in our family. So it was kind of a foreign concept to us. So when I came into the ministry, I realized there's a lot of anxious people. And it consumed a lot of the counseling that I ended up helping people in. And anxious people always assumed the worst would happen. And I realized that it became, was it pessimists that were more anxious or optimists were able to overcome, you know, the half glass, you know, situation? Is it half full or half empty? Can I tell you, we're missing the point there. The glass is refillable. So it's not if it's half empty or half full. It's not if you're optimist or pessimist. The fact is that you can be filled up with God's goodness and his love and his grace and his mercy to overcome and wash out all the anxiety that captures your life. You know, I recognize that oftentimes in my experiences that the world teach us that is a way to live constantly in fear, constantly in anxiety. And a lot of Christians actually believed that false narrative and applied it to their Christian life. And we're always looking for the worst. Can I tell you, there's a lot of people who are thinking that the future is filled with all kinds of terrible, terrible things because they're filled with so much anxiety. But I tell you, the best days of the church are ahead of us. I believe a revival is coming where many will be swept into the kingdom of God. See, I'm choosing to be filled by God's presence. And with that expectation, I'm believing that God wants to fill many people with his presence and that good things are about to happen. And I believe that for Kitchener-Waterloo region, come on, church, let's get ready to see a harvest of souls, the sons and daughters, the orphans, the prodigals, all coming to the house of the Lord to worship God with abandon. Can you imagine that with me? So let's not be pessimistic, or let's not be filled with anxiety thinking bad days are ahead of us. We're going to get through the pandemic. Trust me, we will. But God's got something good in store for us. Hallelujah. Number three, this is an important little thought here. Number three is the solution. Cast your cares on the one who cares for you. I want you to write that down, because this is the solution. Cast your cares on the one who cares for you. So cast your cares. What does cares mean? What cares do you have? Right? We that's interesting that those two words are played against each other there. See, cares is what we carry. But how many people know Jesus carried all our sin and shame and all that solution, so to speak, on the cross? When he went to the cross, he carried the answers, the solutions for us, and he is victorious. He cares for you. He loves you. He has a great future for you. I'm not just talking about the church in general or the church in Kitchener-Waterloo. I'm talking about you. God cares for you. So cast your cares, those worries and anxieties, on the one who cares for you. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 6 to 7. I'm going to read it from the Amplified Translation. Therefore, this is the solution, remember? Therefore, humble yourselves. Amplified says, demote, lower yourselves in your own estimation. I love what C.S. Lewis says about humility. Humility is not thinking less of yourself, it's just thinking of yourself less. Isn't that a great definition? So humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that in due time he may lift you, exalt you, casting the whole of your care. Okay, here it is. This is what it means. All your anxieties, all your worries, all your concerns, once and for all, on him, on Jesus. For he cares for you affectionately, and he cares about you watchfully. Isn't that a great translation of those scriptures? Like, I love those two verses, but the Amplified just makes it louder. It's amazing. So good. Since Jesus invites us to cast all of our care on him, why do so many people refuse to do so? Why do so many people hang on to their cares and not let God take care of things? Apparently, we're not yet fed up with being miserable. The only way to have victory in our lives is to live by God's way. So we have a very clear mandate in these two verses in 1 Peter chapter 5. It says, you know, we must quit holding on to anxiety. We can't hold on to it and try to be rid of it. We've got to learn to let it go. If you want to have peace in your life, you've got to make room by removing the anxiety so that peace, the shalom of God, can come. So when things come our way that cause us to be anxious, and they'll probably cause every day something to come into your life that will cause some kind of anxiety in your life. So what we need to do is recognize immediately we need God's help, because we can't overcome anxiety on our own. No self-help book will help you to deal with anxiety. Like spear, it's a fear, you know, like a fear is a spirit. Anxiety works in the same kind of way. So we need God's help. So how do we get it? 1 Peter, right there, chapter 5, verse 6 and 7 lists two important things, and I'll throw them right up so you can write these things down. Number one, humble yourselves. We don't always like that, but that's the solution. Humble yourselves. And number two, cast your care upon him. You know what casting, you ever fishing idea? You were casting, so you're literally throwing it away to him for God to catch what you're giving him. Now, that seems pretty clear, and it seems pretty simple, but yet it doesn't seem very easy for many of us. We continue to struggle with anxiety, And it's shown in this truth because either we're, and I'll be very kind here, we're bullheaded, we're stubborn. We think that we can solve these problems on our own, and we don't really trust that God really wants to take care of these things. You say, well, this is not a big deal. I'll let God hang out, you know, with the big stuff in my life. God cares about everything that you care about. And so why not try it God's way? All of us would be totally better off if we learned to lean on God and ask for his help right away. Instead of waiting as a last resort, let's go to God right away. So, as long as we try to do everything ourselves, instead of what the book says, instead of what God is saying to us, God will let us. He will. He'll let us try to work things out on ourselves if that's what we want to do. Or if we open the Word of God and we put 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 6 and 7 into our lives, into our thinking, and into our actions, then we're going to see the victory. So, He won't take care of the problems that we won't give him. Our worries, our cares, our anxieties, until we turn them loose, he's just waiting. His arms are wide open, but he's waiting for us to give them to him. Either we're going to do it or God's going to do it. It's not both at the same time. So you make a choice right here, and that is humility. That's bowing our hearts to say, God, I recognize that only you can help me here. And so we humble ourselves and we say, yes, help me. Now, casting your care doesn't mean that you can be irresponsible. Oh, it's up to God. He's going to take care of it. And still carry on with foolishness. That's not what I'm saying here. God won't do for you what you can do for yourself. There's some people who say, oh, God, I'm just going to pray about it. And you don't even have to pray about certain things. You just need to obey some things. And just don't make the excuse that praying about it, you're just putting it off, you're procrastinating. No, when God says to obey, you don't even have to pray about it because you know what to do. And God's not going to do for you what you can do for yourself. So it's the things that we need to put into motion. So when we humble ourselves, because that's what he's asking, and we ask for his help, then he's there and he's able to release us from that anxiety. It's an amazing thing. The moment that happens for you, and the power of God comes into your situations, and it's only then that we can really enjoy the abundant, blessed life that God's promised for us. Isn't that a good thing? So the cure for anxiety, just in case there's anybody not quite clear about what I'm saying, is number one, humbling yourselves before God, and number two, casting your cares on him by trusting in him to take care of those situations. So instead of making our lives more miserable and trying to figure everything out on our own, God wants us to place our trust in him. I'm going to leave it right there. And to rest in him. And to believe that God can do what he says he can do. Would that be good? Absolutely. Let me read Psalm 37, verse 3 to you. Just the first part of it. This is it right here. So what it says. Trust. Trust in the Lord. Trust in the Lord and do good. Do good to yourself. Do good for others. But some of you need to be good to yourself. Those who struggle with anxiety, you need to just take a deep breath and don't be so hard on yourself. Don't treat yourself so harshly. Do good to yourself. Spend time with God. See, God didn't want us to create us to be consumed with helping ourselves all the time. You know, he really wants to step in there and help you. So do good to yourself and let God. And the other thing is, do good to others. Because if we're focused on ourselves all the time, what happens is we're going to be reminded of the things that we need and the struggles that we have. But sometimes the biggest blessings, I don't know about you that are here with me today, but some of the biggest blessings have come into my life when I've been trying to help other people. The very thing that God does through me for others is the very thing he's doing in me. And I'll tell you, it's a pretty remarkable thing, is that burden, that heaviness, that care, that worry that was all so consuming you. When I started to pray for others and minister to other people and encourage and hug, and I will hug one day, trust me, we'll be back to hug soon. When we used to do those kind of things, my problems didn't seem that significant. And God showed up with great shalom into my life. Did I still have problems? Yeah, but God's presence was there covering me in those moments. Beautiful thing. So what I'm just talking about there is point number four, is developing an attitude of faith and prayer. See, when I care about what Psalm 37 says, where I'm going to trust the Lord and I'm going to do good and to others, myself and others, then what happens is I'm developing a different kind of attitude towards my problems and developing an attitude of faith and an attitude of prayer in the midst of these. I've learned that my attitude has a lot to do with conquering anxiety. I've had things I've had to overcome when it comes to anxiety. Trust me, I'm normal. Absolutely. There will always be situations that cause concern for us. If you've got kids, you've faced anxiety piles of times just because they're kids, right? When they're a baby, are they breathing at night? When they're a toddler, oh, they're going to kill themselves jumping off, throughout the teenager. Oh my gosh, who are their friends? All throughout life, you're never going to stop being concerned about it, and it's easy for anxiety to grip you. So listen, we all struggle with situations, but with God's help, we can live above it, and we can enjoy the peace that God wants to bring. Hallelujah. Cast your care on the Lord, because I'm going to say this again, because I trust you, God. My heart goes to Him. An attitude of faith is I'm going to trust you. I'm going to pray in the Spirit. I'm going to pray that God would lift this concern, this heaviness, and I'm going to enjoy the life you've given me. Lord, I'm going to enjoy today. This is the day that the Lord has made, and I will rejoice and be glad in it. Am I just denying the reality? No, I'm placing my faith in a greater reality that God's got me covered. This is good. So when you give your problems to God, you also must be satisfied with His answers. Trusting God, having faith in God, that He's going to do what's best for us, is a huge thing. It's really important. And that's where it involves dying to self. And when we learn how to die to self, prayer becomes actually quite easy. It's one of those things that is the end result of our choosing to die to ourselves and trusting God. We end up just praying as a natural result of that amazing thing. I want to look at Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. This is what I'm talking about here. It explains it so well. It is no longer I who live, but Christ, the Messiah, the Anointed One, lives in me. And the life I now live in the body, I live by faith in, is amplified again, watch this, by adherence to and reliance and complete trust in, isn't that great, the Son of God, who loved me and gave Himself up for me. Wow. So when you have an attitude of faith and prayer, you can trust God that He's going to do what's best for you. So you don't have to be anxious. That's such an important thing. So having this positive heart attitude, having this prayer that joins with your positive heart attitude actually becomes such a beautiful thing that you get to cultivate, and it becomes a habit, a good habit in your life where you're not relying on anxiety and fretting, where now you're relying on God, and wow, what a difference that makes. So we must stop trying to make things happen the way we want. God's going to work in your life. He's going to resolve those things. And He's going to get us to a place where we desire to please God more than we want to please ourselves, and that we trust Him with our kids, we trust Him with our business, we trust Him with our finances, we begin to trust Him with every area. Faith in the Word of God will help you overcome anxiety. Fretting involves negative thoughts. Faith involves trusting and these positive things that God wants to do in your life. So, dismiss the negative thought patterns that anxiety has built up in your life over the years, and build by the Word of God new faith patterns of thinking, and let that become the new normal in your life. It's a faith attitude. I'll say that again. And it can help us even overcome the past, the regrets, not just frets, but regrets. And so a faith attitude can do even that much more, preparing you for your future, for what God has for you, to lead you into a good future. And so take the shield of faith to protect you from every fiery dart of the enemy. Like I mentioned, it's a powerful gift that this the armor of God, the shield of faith, is for us. And let every fiery dart fizzle out when it hits your shield of faith. Glory to God. Last thing I'm going to say, I'm going to read you one more scripture, is don't complicate your prayer life. Just keep it really simple. Some people say it's the flowery words, it's the big words. No, just have confidence in the simple, trusting prayer like a child would talk to a parent. Just keep it simple. Don't try to impress yourself. Sometimes maybe we just pray to impress others, but sometimes we even pray to impress ourselves. God's smiling. He loves you. He even knows what you're thinking before you say it. So just have a conversation. Keep it simple. Look at the instructions that Paul leaves with the Philippians, and I'll leave these instructions for you today as I close. Verse 6 and 7 of chapter 4. Do not fret or have any anxiety. Any anxiety about anything. But in every circumstance and in everything, by prayer and petition, which is definite requests, with thanksgiving, continue to make your wants known to God, your needs and your wants. Yeah, it says wants here. So it's not just the things you need. Just that's really important for you to understand, because we're going to filter them through the word and the will of God. So it's beautiful, right? And God's peace shall be yours. That tranquil state of a soul assured of its salvation through Christ. And so fearing nothing from God and being content with its earthly lot of whatsoever that is, that peace, which transcends all understanding, shall garrison, what a great word, garrison, guard, protect, garrison, and mount guard over your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Wow, isn't that fantastic? What scripture, man. The Bible is so faithful to tell us exactly the way God thinks about us. He is so good to us, and we need to keep focusing on what God says and not what our thoughts are telling us, not what our anxieties are trying to raise a banner in our lives. Hey, pay attention to me. No, no, no. We're going to lift up the word of the Lord. And, we, you know, Philippians 4, verse 6 to 7, come on. This would be great scripture read when you're filled with anxious thoughts. Fret can go. Anxiety can go. And God's peace can come in Jesus' name. Lord, I thank you for my friends watching today. And as we just rest in the reality of your word, I thank you, Father, that your truth, your word, will transform us. And we take it to heart, and we praise you for the life that it brings us. And now we're going to serve you, Lord, with it by following through, by acting out those things we've heard today in Jesus' name. Amen.